Well, good morning. We are glad you're here. We want to welcome all of you today, whether you're joining us online or whether you're here in the room. We are really glad you're here. I especially want to give a special welcome to all of the dads who got their children here this morning with their wives on the women's retreat. And I want to give a special kudos to any dad whose daughter's hair looks decent this morning, all right? And so that's a great accomplishment just to get that done on women's retreat weekend. But seriously, if you are visiting with us, we're glad you're here, and we'd love to know you, know a little bit about you, get you anything that you need in terms of information and so forth. There's several ways to do that. One is to go on our website to the Connect page on our website. Another is to go right back here to the foyer that's back behind this room outside the Fellowship Hall. There's a Connect Center there. There'll be people there that can help you. We also have contact cards in the pews there that you can fill out, drop them in the offering box, and we will let you know. We'll get back in touch with you very soon. So we'd just like to know who you are. If you'll take a look at the back of your bulletin, back there you'll see a number of important announcements, things that are going on. Also, just call your attention to the financial report back there. We are kind of in that season of the year prior to December where we start to fall a little bit behind. So if you can help us a little on that and just pray and then just do whatever God leads you to do, we would appreciate that. Tonight at 6 p.m. back in the chapel is the World Prayer Focus. It's an opportunity that we have to gather together, pray for the church, pray for the country, for our county and city governments, for state government, for the world, for our church, for every facet of life that we are connected to. We want to let you know about a couple of things. You know, protecting life is an important aspect of our work as believers. There are two ways you can specifically help with that right now. One is, if you've never done so, and even if you have, consider being a blood donor. We have a blood drive here a couple times a year. That's going to be this Wednesday night from 4 to 7, so we would encourage you, even if you've never done it before, we've got our regulars that do it, but even if you've never done it before, when that's needed, it's really needed. And being someone who's been the recipient of the need end of that, it's something that I take seriously, and if you can help us with that, you can register online or you can talk to Sam Heslop, and he will be glad to get you registered for that. Also, Tuesdays during October, end of September and October, first of is serving with 40 Days of Life campaign where we stand in pairs down outside Planned Parenthood and pray. Pray that God will deliver unborn children from the travesties of abortion. And a lot of folks think, well, you know, abortion got outlawed in Tennessee. Yes, but there's vans running to Illinois every day. And so we need to continue to be proactive in that. We need to continue to be prayerful in that and recognize that this battle is not over and this issue is not done. It is still taking place all around us. This Thursday at 11:45, back in the chapel, we have our monthly caregivers meeting. I'll actually be speaking this week, and I want to talk about putting your own mask on first. As a caregiver, it's easy to completely deplete yourself. And so one of the things we want to talk about is how you can stay healthy, stay in good shape to be an effective caregiver. Caregivers are not just people that are living in the home with a person that's incapable of taking care of themselves. It also involves some of us who have been in situations where we're caring or are responsible for an older parent who may be in a facility, who may be living even independently, but we are a major caregiver to that person. It is easy to exhaust yourself in that process, and so we encourage you to come out and be part of that. Lunch is provided. We do ask you to register for that event so that we know how many folks are coming. Let's worship the Lord together now.
It is gloomy outside, but inside here in this room, we get to celebrate with the joy of the Lord what the Lord has done for us. The Apostle John was very close to Jesus while he was on earth, but when he saw the exalted Lord Jesus in the book of Revelation, Jesus' eyes were a flame of fire. He shone like the sun, and John, of course, was overwhelmed and fell at Jesus' feet. Jesus laid his hand on him and said this, "Fear not, I am the first and the last and the living one. I died, and behold, I am alive forevermore, and I have the keys of death and Hades. This morning, we worship the one who lives forever and has power over heaven and hell. Let's stand together and sing of his victory over the grave. Let's affirm our faith together reading these words from the Apostles' Creed. When it says Catholic, it's not referring to the Roman Catholic Church, but the universal worldwide church. I believe in
God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead.
God the uncreated one, the author of salvation, who wrote the laws of space and time, who fashioned worlds to his design, the one whom angel hosts revere on the stars like chandeliers, numbered every grain of sand, knows the heart of every man. He is King forever. He is King forever. He is King forevermore.
Lord, you alone are the one that we can trust.
God, our refuge and our strength, the rock on which we can depend. Matchless in his majesty, his power and authority. Unshaken by the schemes of man, never changing, great I am. Kingdoms rise and kingdoms fall, he is faithful through it all. Crown him King forever, crown him King forever, crown him King forevermore. Forsaken by a traitor's kiss, the curse of sin and centuries did pierce the lonely Prince of Peace. Lifted high the sinless man, crucified the spotless lamb, buried by the sons of man, Jesus, my Savior, Lord, there is none like you. All of my days I want to praise the wonders of your mighty love. My comfort, my shelter, tower.
Since I was 13, I was gangster to my heart. Banging every night, hold up, let me start. In and out the streets, selling treats to the weak. Yeah, that was me with the new kicks on my feet like every other week. I was looking good on the outside, but hurting on the inside. My mama doing drugs, my sister going wild. Trying to keep the grades and not go insane. Trying to maintain and not show my pain. While I was putting on a show, I was letting the pain grow, but someone pulled me to the side to let me know that my relationship with Christ was torn and it was time for me to be reborn. As I sat there and started to think, I realized the way I was living was unpleasant and not in his sight. As I started to confess my sins, I felt the blood of Jesus take its cover and my past was over and I was a child set free.
Good morning. My name is Stephen Yeo, and I am the local director at First Savannah. And here with me, I have Pearl Lee, who's the executive director of Youth Striving for Excellence. And I have Jasmine Robinson, who is the assistant director of clinical services at Youth Villages. So, Jasmine, thank you for sharing the poem. Can you tell us what that is about?
I grew up in north side of Memphis. My mom was addicted to crack cocaine. Majority of my life, I was raised by my grandparents. I ended up joining a gang. I was selling drugs. I was just doing pretty much whatever I wanted to. My cousin introduced me to Miss Pearl at a very young, rebellious age. And Youth Striving for Excellence changed the trajectory of my life. I learned a lot of things, but the most important thing, I learned that I was a child of God, and my sins were forgiven. It was just the base of everything. I ended up going to Well, I graduated from high school with honors, which we didn't know if I was going to graduate. I went to undergrad as well as grad school. And yeah, because of you striving for excellence, yeah, I'm a successful adult. And I learned the importance of sticking with God and just allowing him to lead and guide you. And I now stand as the assistant director of clinical services at Euphilogus.
It's a crazy story of God redeeming you so that you could redeem other people. Yes. So praise God. Pearl, it's the 30th year of You Striving for Excellence. So how can we come alongside with you to God?
I just want you all to pray for God to keep his arms and protection around the Youth Striving for Excellence ministry, which we call WISE, and to bless us to continue our outreach efforts to lead young people and their families to Christ as they develop a strong relationship with him, as well as break negative patterns of behavior and teach valuable life skills.
Thank you, Pearl. If you are interested in getting to know Jasmine or Pearl or their ministry, they will be here after service. Come and check them out. Thank you.
Let me just go ahead and pray for y'all, and then y'all can have a seat. Father, thank you for this ministry that has been a redeeming force of yours in the city for a long time. I thank you for the opportunity that many First Event folks have had and other churches and other Christians in town have had to walk with them and see you at work in their lives. Father, it's a serious example of seeing where you are at work and our chance to come alongside. I pray that you bless this ministry for the things that Pearl just asked for. And we thank you for the young person that was recently baptized after KAA camp. And we pray for health for the students and the families. And we pray for a lot of participation from the young people and their families as they kick off their fall ministries. And so bless them as they bless your name. Amen. Amen. So, join me now for another season of prayer. Thank you, ladies. Father, Jesus, Spirit, dear Father, Jesus, and Spirit, we give you the glory for Jasmine's song. Like Moses's or David's, her song is a witness to your mercy and grace and power to redeem us from the power of sin and death. When I read her poem, you made me think of Ephesians 2. And we were dead in the trespasses and sins in which we once walked, following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience, among whom we all once lived in the passions of our flesh, carrying out the desires of the body and mind, and were by nature children of wrath, like the rest of mankind. But you, God, being rich in mercy, because of your great love with which you loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, you made us alive together with Christ. By grace we have been saved, and you raised us up with him and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus. May the song of our gospel witness ring as true as Jasmine's. Bless her and keep her, as well as Pearl and Youth Striving for Excellence. Father, we lift up praises to you that Judith and Pradeep have found a house in Cordova, that the trip to Laos was productive for teaching and equipping the church. May their new home be a place of witness and hospitality. Bless Hickman's and Pradeep's trip to India and Nepal in October, that these faraway saints would be encouraged. Lord, we rejoice with Jackie Zawicki over the birth of Judah Stephen Zawicki, born this week to Rebecca and Micah. Bless Judah and his mother and dad. Lord, bring warm comfort to the families of Jim Henry and Rick Orr. Thank you for the years they sang a song of gospel witness into our lives. Amid sorrow, we rejoice, for they now are singing a new song that will last for eternity. We long for the day, may we long for the day, we join them and all the saints who are singing your praise in heaven. Father, strengthen Daryl Sanders and Virginia Birchfield as they rehab and recover. May they know your strength when perhaps they feel they have none left. Lord, you are a generous God. You have showered us immeasurably with mercy and grace in our lives. And you have blessed this church financially. May we be good stewards and be generous as you lead us in support of the church and in all that you call us to. Great King Jesus, Paul's words to the Ephesians are not just those for those trapped in drugs and gangs. We all have followed the prince of the power of air as sons and daughters of disobedience and are by nature children of wrath. But you, O God, by your mercy, because of your great love, have made all of us who believe alive in you. As Jasmine sung, your blood took its cover and our past was over. Amen and amen. We give you all the glory and honor forever and ever. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Well, amen. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. What a great day to worship with one another. Such a blessing to be here. I certainly missed preaching last Sunday, but so thankful for Gabor and his ministry of the Word in particular. So thankful for that. We're going to continue in our series in Nehemiah. So if you've got your Bible, which I hope you do, go ahead and meet me there in Nehemiah chapter 2. If you're visiting with us and maybe you didn't bring a Bible, there should be a Bible there in the pew in front of you, and I'd invite you to turn there so you can follow along with us. We're going to look today for some principles of leadership here in this text. In fact, I would argue that the 10 or so verses that we're going to cover here are probably the best literature on leadership that's ever been written right here in what we're going to find today. I've been saying a couple times throughout this sermon series that leadership is influence. And we're really going to start right here in this passage. And we're going to start to see Nehemiah's effect on the people, his influence on the people. So that's what we're looking for today. Nehemiah 2, we're going to read verses 11 through the end of the chapter. And I want to invite you one more time, if you would just stand in honor of the reading of God's word, if you're able. This is Nehemiah 2. So I came to Jerusalem and was there 3 days. And I arose in the night, I and a few men with me. I did not tell anyone what my God was putting into my mind to do for Jerusalem. And there was no animal with me except the animal on which I was riding. So I went out at night by the valley gate in the direction of the dragon's well and onto the refuse gate, inspecting the walls of Jerusalem, which were broken down, and its gates, which were consumed by fire. Then I passed on to the fountain gate and the king's pool, but there was no place for my mount to pass. So I went up at night by the ravine and inspected the wall. Then I entered the valley gate again and returned. The officials did not know where I had gone or what I had done, nor had I as yet told the Jews, the priests, the nobles, the officials, or the rest who did the work. Verse 17, then I said to them, you see the bad situation we are in, that Jerusalem is desolate and its gates burned by fire. Come, let us rebuild the wall of Jerusalem so that we will no longer be a reproach. I told them how the hand of my God had been favorable to me, and also about the king's words which he had spoken to me. Then they said, let us arise and build. So they put their hands to the good work. But when Sanballat the Horonite and Tobiah the Ammonite official and Geshem the Arab heard it, they mocked us and despised us and said, what is this thing you are doing? Are you rebelling against the king? So I answered then and said to them, the God of heaven will give us success. Therefore, we his servants will arise and build, but you have no portion, right, or memorial in Jerusalem. Well, first of all, the grass withers and the flower fades, but the word of our God stands forever. Amen. You can be seated. Heavenly Father, you speak now. Stand in my body. Think with my mind. Speak with my voice. I'll be so very careful to give you all the glory and all the honor and all the praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, verse 11 begins, so I came to Jerusalem. It's finally here, but let me just stop you and try to orient us, maybe reorient us from one week apart from Nehemiah to what's going on here. In the 20th year of King Artaxerxes, a cupbearer by the name of Nehemiah was out for an evening stroll. And while he was on that walk, he heard maybe an accent that was familiar to him. It was one of his brothers, Hannah. Hannah and I had just returned back from Judah to where they were, which was Susa, the capital, and Nehemiah inquires about the trip. Well, he tells them the bad news, that Jerusalem is in a poor state. It's in shambles. The wall of Jerusalem has been torn down. It's broken down. The gates are burned by fire. And this news moves Nehemiah. It moves him. He's distressed. He weeps. He mourns for days. And it stirs him up into a season of prayer. In fact, we saw close somewhere in the neighborhood of 100 days of prayer from the month Chislev to the month Nisan. There's Nehemiah praying. He's praying about what he has heard. And we, of course, saw in that sermon that he was trying to pray a final prayer in that time. He was working from a first prayer to a final prayer, a prayer that could be answered. Well, eventually that burden he was feeling in his heart shows up on his face. The face is the mirror of the heart, we said 2 weeks ago, and that was certainly the case. And that sadness sort of comes up to his face, and the king notices that sadness, and he asks about it. He inquires about it. In the midst of this sort of waiting and praying, Nehemiah had waited for the right time to act, the right time to do the right thing. And he speaks up to the king, and he shares what has distressed him about his father's land having been torn down. And he asks the king for a decade of PTO. Can you imagine asking your boss for that? But he goes and he asks for 12 years of paid time off from the king, along with various resources. And guess what? The good hand of God was upon him. And the king grants his request that he would go to Judah, the city of his father's tomb, and rebuild it. Well, first of all, feel it. Feel the timeline. Okay, you need to feel the timeline. He's heard about the news, about the city, about the glory of God. He hears it and he prays for 4 months. Feel it. He's been distressed. He's felt this burden on his heart for 4 months. And finally, he goes to the king. He asks the king for permission. He gets what he needs. He's been granted the permission, the leave to go. But remember, he's in Susa, the capital. He's 850 miles from Jerusalem, 1,000 miles based on the way that the roads would take him. He's 1,000 miles from Jerusalem. I don't know if you've ever taken a long trip. 1,000 miles is a long trip in a car going 75 or 85, depending on how risk-loving you are. And you know what it's like to get from a long trip. You get out of your car, you stretch your back, right? You're exhausted. You're excited to be there. 2008, I flew to Sydney, Australia. I think at the time it was one of the longest flights you could take. We were on that plane, 15 hours, coach seat, cramped up, and we land there. And what's everyone do? Immediately stands up, feels the aisle. You know what I'm talking about. Those people as if they're going to get off the plane faster. And everybody stands up. We've been there. We've been cramped. And somehow, God bless this pilot, he managed to get our plane wedged in between two other planes, and the jetway couldn't get out to our door. And we had to call one of those little tractor deals, and it rocked us back and forth until we could get back to the jetway there. Well, let me tell you something. 15 hours, I was ready to get out. All right, threatening to open the emergency exit. Nehemiah travels 1,000 miles. By all estimates, right, probably 10 miles a day the man had traveled. He'd been traveling 100 days. And he finally gets there. So I came to Jerusalem. First man, feel it. Feel the text. He heard the news. He prayed for 100 days, carried this burden in prayer. He waited for the opportune, the right time to do the right thing to the king. He gets his permission. He travels for another 100 days. Feel it. And you just know he comes into Jerusalem, and you just know here's a man who's itching to get to work. And what's the text say? I came to Jerusalem and was there 3 days. What'd you do for the 3 days, Nehemiah? He took a nap. He rested, friends, and rightfully so. He comes there and he rests. In fact, it's the first point that I want to make today. Upon Nehemiah's arrival, what's he do? Number one, he rests. First, you have to see the rest. For 3 days, he rests. Now look, in verse 12, you're going to see him get up in the night, take a survey of the land, but not yet. For 3 days, Nehemiah enters into the land and he rests. He received the news. He prayed. He waited. And he traveled, and now he's resting. What's the principle? Well, before everything starts, everything must stop. And so he stops. he rests. Well, why? We got to ask the question, why? Well, one of the reasons that he stops for 3 days to rest is because exhaustion is the enemy of leadership. Exhaustion is the enemy of leadership. He can't make wise decisions exhausted from a 100-day journey. And so he rests. He rests. Now, I'm going to talk about this in my context because it's what I understand best. I'm going to trust that you can translate it into your own context. But I've noticed after 15 some odd years of ministry that an exhausted shepherd has patience that runs thin, cynicism that runs high. A pastor needs to rest. A pastor needs to rest from the soul work that he does every single day. If he's going to have a long, faithful, fruitful ministry, he needs to rest. In fact, it's the very idea where we get this concept of a sabbatical. A pastor needs to go. He needs to be sent away for a moment to rest, to go on a sabbatical, because the principle is that first a van is served best by shepherds who are well rested, who are refreshed. And so we send them away on a sabbatical. Now, here's why I bring this up. Because there's something lurking behind that that we have to understand. There's something lurking in the background of that that we have to understand. You see, ultimately, the sabbatical is less about rest and more about an exercise of faith in God's gracious provision. That's what it's teaching us. That oftentimes we don't rest because we think that we're the only ones that can do the job. That's sad to admit. That's humbling to admit, but I know that to be true because I've thought that thought. I have thought the thought, man, what would this church do without me? You see, what rest does, what a sabbatical does, is it teaches us something, that God is accomplishing his work. It turns out it's Jesus that builds the church and not Pace. So it doesn't matter how much work I do. It's one of the reasons we send a pastor away on sabbatical. It's the same idea why Bill Granger came up to me this week. When was the last time, Pace, that you took your wife on a date? What was he saying? He was saying, hey, you can't get so busy here. Don't mistake that you can be so busy here that you just build the church. God's going to build it. Trust him. You can trust him in the rest. Well, Nehemiah comes to Jerusalem and he's there for 3 days. He's resting. Certainly resting because it's been an arduous journey, of course. But also resting as a simple reminder that it was God's hand at work that was going to accomplish the task. Don't you remember that? 2 weeks ago, it was the good hand of God on Nehemiah. And Nehemiah is wise. He rests for 3 days. He's wise enough to know that he can't make good decisions while he is tired, because exhaustion makes problems look bigger than they appear. Exhaustion makes tasks seem intolerable. And so we need to remember to rest, because Jesus teaches us in the Bible that sometimes the spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. And so we need to rest. We should rest in the proper time so that we might not fall asleep at the improper time. Rest. I think some believers today confuse activity with spirituality. And God sets it up from the beginning. No, it's not that way. 6 days, God creates man there on the sixth day, commands him, be fruitful, multiply, fill the earth, subdue it. And then what happens on the seventh day? They get to the work of subduing the land? No, they rest. Man rests on their first day. Why? It was a matter of trust. We see the same thing in the life of the church. Jesus gives his disciples the Great Commission in Matthew 28. What's he say? Go and make disciples. He gives them an action, a call to action. But you know, it's an interesting thing. If you look in Luke 24, same account, same event from a different vantage point, recorded by a different author, they get the Great Commission. He commands them, go and make disciples. But there in verse 49, what's it say? He says, tarry in the city. What was he saying? Jesus was saying, go, but wait. Fulfill the action, but rest. Because we can't do effectively what God has called us to do if we do it alone, if we do it on our own timing, or if we do it in our own strength. You can't do it without God. You can't do it. That's what we've been learning for 3 weeks now. Four if you count the week that we've had off. For 3 weeks in preaching Nehemiah, we've been seeing that. You can't do it alone. So pray. That was Nehemiah week two. You can't do it on your own time. So wait. That was Nehemiah week three. You can't do it in your own strength. So rest. That's today. Nehemiah week four. We've seen these lessons played out. We don't have to work 7 days. The Christian doesn't have to labor 7 days. He labors 6 days and he rests as an exercise of faith and trust in what God is doing, that he'll accomplish his work, that it's his good hand at work. So sometimes we need to rest to puncture our own pride just by resting. Resting is an issue of trust. It's an issue of faith. He says, rest before work, wait before going, do more by doing less. Friends, if the Son of God goes up to pray, retreat into the mountains, maybe we should follow his example. Maybe we should consider that what he's teaching us is true. That's why we rest. You see, getting the work done starts with rested leadership. So upon arrival, what's Nehemiah do? Well, number one, notice the rest. Number two, notice the reconnaissance, the reconnaissance. When the 3 days of resting concludes, verse 12, Nehemiah arose in the night to conduct some reconnaissance. It's going to teach you a word that you need to learn if it's not in your vocabulary, reconnoiter. Okay, reconnoiter. That's the act of reconnaissance. Okay, reconnaissance, that's the noun. Reconnoiter is the verb. And so Nehemiah reconnoiters. He goes out at night. He does some recon work. We know that from military language, right? They go out, they sort of survey the mission. And Nehemiah does exactly that. When the rest is over, he goes out. And I've never been in the armed forces. I don't know exactly what that is, but my assumption is they go out, they gather information, they look at the area, they understand the size, the position of what they're up against. Well, verse 12, I didn't tell anyone what God was putting into my mind for Jerusalem. You see, in and through his reconnaissance, God is prompting, continuously prompting Nehemiah. That idea right there, it's this word picture of that God was pouring something into his mind. He was pouring something into his heart. It's captured really well here in the NASB. In the Hebrew, it's a participle, right? It's continuous action. In the Hebrew, a participle is always continuous action. He was putting it into mind. God was putting into mind. It's not completed past tense. I think some versions of the Bible are weakening that by saying it's completed. No, he was putting it into mind. You see, through the reconnaissance, God was still pouring that vision into Nehemiah's mind. It'd been hundreds of days, praying, traveling, resting, but he was pouring it out as Nehemiah goes out for some reconnaissance. It's this idea I mentioned 2 weeks ago that there's stages to a vision. There's stages to it. First, there's conception, but then there's gestation, where it's developing. That's what's going on here. Eventually, there'll be birth and adoption and growth, but here it's still coming together. And that's what leaders do. They go out, they survey, they understand, that they get the vision. They need to conduct the proper recon that like Nehemiah is doing right here in our text so that they're set up for success. Because nothing undermines leadership like a failed start or a failed project. A good leader goes out for recon. He knows. He can't get so far ahead of his own people that they mistake him for the enemy. And so he goes out. He wants to understand the project. He conducts a feasibility project, if you will, study. Verse 13, he's out to spy on the walls. What's it say, verse 13? He's inspecting the walls of Jerusalem. The concept there behind inspecting is he's looking into the walls. This was not a cursory glance. This was not a quick look as he passed by. No, he was inspecting. It's this idea that he was boring into the walls to examine them. Like a doctor examines a patient. Again, I'm not a surgeon, but I would suspect a good surgeon doesn't just take a quick glance at the X-rays or the CAT scans and then cuts the patient open. No, right? At least I hope not. They look, they study the scans, they put a plan together for when the surgery commences. That's what Nehemiah is doing here in the reconnaissance. So upon arrival, there's the rest. There's the reconnaissance. Notice two observations. I don't want to call them points. I just observations I see here in the text that I think are noteworthy. Number one, note the secrecy. Note the secrecy here. Look at it in the text. I did not tell anyone. I arose in the night. There was no animal with me except the animal on which I was riding. Doesn't want to make a bunch of noise. Sort of gives this idea, just like special forces would sort of parachute in quietly. He goes in quietly. He knew that there were some opposed to the project. He'd already met Sanballat and Tobiah there. He knows that the enemy is there. He doesn't want to give them the advantage of knowing what his thoughts were before he had the plan all together. And so he goes out quietly. He's allowing God to pour that vision into his mind and into his heart. That's what good leaders do. They have to do that. They have to understand right timing for when they should tell people. I've got a good friend in ministry, Johnny, and he always, he tells me, he says, everyone wants to be a leader until they realize how lonely it is at the top. And perhaps that's Nehemiah. He knows how lonely it's going to be. And so before it all starts, he just takes a moment to secretly understand the project. This is what leaders do. Leaders lie awake at night, trying to figure out what's going on. They lie awake at night wondering, how are we going to disciple all these people? How are we going to properly shepherd them? How are we going to take care of our staff? How are we going to secure good financial standing? It keeps you up at night. You're thinking about that. All through the pastoral search process, ask me, what would you do? What are you going to do at First Van? I'm on verse 12. God's still putting it in my mind. I'm still listening. I'm still praying. And so it's a work. It's a work on the behalf of the leader. It's a work on behalf of the followers. Do you trust the leadership as they conduct the recon? It's not an absence of leadership. It's the waiting for effective leadership. Notice a second point, second observation here. He doesn't go out alone. Look at verse 12. I arose in the night, I and a few men with me. There's a principle at play here, that teams outperform individuals every time. And so Nehemiah goes out with a few. He understands that two are better than one. He understands the biblical principle that a cord of three strands is not easily broken. So he takes a few men with him, a few close advisors, not too many. Didn't want to make a bunch of noise. Didn't need a bunch of, donkeys and horses walking around at night, alerting people to what's going on. He gets a few, though. He doesn't go alone. He's got a balanced sounding board, people that he can share with. Well, what's he find in his reconnaissance? Well, it's exactly like Hannah and I had reported. The walls are down. The gates are burned. And here is where the leader is forged. Here's where the leader is made. He observes the bad news firsthand. Is he going to quit? Is he going to back out? No, Nehemiah's a leader. He's not afraid. Leaders aren't afraid of the reality. They understand hard work. They understand hard work's not a substitute for smart work. It's why he was going out to plan what was going on. It wasn't unplanned. He didn't leave things to chance. This wasn't a let go and let God. No, God doesn't bless our foolishness. No, he investigates, walking by faith, but he's planning. He's thinking it through thoroughly. Gonna edit this language because it's a military saying and we're in church. The military has a saying, proper prior planning prevents pitifully poor performance. Say that fast. Proper prior planning prevents pitifully poor performance. Nehemiah understood it. He understood that. And so he spent some time in recon, quietly, with a few close advisors. Okay, there's the rest upon arrival. There's the reconnaissance on arrival. And then third, finally, there's Nehemiah. There's the recruitment. The recruitment. Notice Nehemiah's recruitment. He needs to gather some helpers. Speaks of them in verse 17. You'll see that pronoun there, them. He's referring back, I think, to the list there in verse 16. He needs to get some people to join him. But notice how he does it. He's not going to push them. Leaders don't push. Leaders don't cajole. Leaders don't manipulate. They motivate. And that's what he's going to do here. He's going to move them towards action. President Truman says that his definition of a leader in a free country is someone who can persuade people to do what they don't want to do and to like it. That's what Nehemiah is going to do. Packer, J.R. Packer has a wonderful book on Nehemiah. It's been very helpful in my thinking about this book. He says a leader is a person who can persuade others to embrace their purpose. That's what Nehemiah is going to do here. He knows in order to get the job done, he needs to get them to do it and to like doing it. A test for leadership is to look over your shoulder. It's to see if anyone is following. You got to have a followership. You can't have leadership without a followership. It's the same truth at play. You're not a teacher if your students aren't learning. You might have the title of teacher, but if your students aren't learning, then you're not a teacher, right? No learners, not a teacher. No followers, not a leader. Nehemiah needs to go out. He needs to recruit some people. He needs to get them to see what he has already sees. That's a truth about leaders. Leaders see things. A lot of times they see things first, but then they get others to see what they've already seen. Look at verse 17. Then I said to them, you see the bad situation we're in, that Jerusalem is desolate, that its gates are burned with fire. First of all, Nehemiah, he's calling them to have eyes to see, to perception. You see the bad situation we're in. You see it, right? It's almost like he's asking them a question. He needs to get them to see the desolation that he sees. And here's the truth. The truth is that Nehemiah saw more in the night than the average Jew saw in the day. Good leaders do that. Nehemiah saw more in the night than the average person saw in the day. Leaders have clear perception, and that's what he's doing. He's saying, do you see what I see? Is that Bing Crosby song? Do you see what I see? Star, star. Y'all love that. Don't act like y'all don't love that song. No, y'all can sing that all the way home, okay? He's saying, do you see what I see? He wants to get them to see the bad. He's pointing at the wall. You see the bad situation we're in? Jerusalem's a joke. And by the way, notice his similarity in the language between chapter 2, verse 15 and chapter 1, verse 3. Almost the exact same language. He wants to move people to be moved by what moves him. That's what a good leader does. It's to move them to see it. I think we can get used to the context that we live in. It's dangerous. We can get used to a frustrating marriage. We can get used to mediocrity. We can get used to prayerlessness. But leaders help you see things that you're not seeing. We need to ask God to give us fresh pairs of eyes. We need to ask God to let us see in the night what we don't see in the day. And we should be careful, because when we see those things, a lot of times people don't like it. Makes them feel uncomfortable. They're comfortable. It challenges their status quo. But a leader has to move them out to action. 1959, Walt Disney had a vision to carve out of 40-something square miles of Florida swamp Disney World. This vision for it. Well, he died before the vision was completed. And on the grand opening of the park, Mike Vance, who's a high Disney executive, wrote a wonderful book, was there at the grand opening, and a journalist asked him, he said, you know, isn't it too bad that Walt Disney didn't see all this? And he responded, he did see it. That's why it's here. That's Nehemiah. First event, what did you see this morning? What did you see this morning on your drive here? Did you see a wonderful neighborhood with fences and fresh painted houses? Or did you see a neighborhood filled with sleeping souls who are about to start stirring to worship the Sunday football gods? What did you see? What did you see when you pulled onto campus this morning? What did you see? Do you see what God sees? Nehemiah took a walk by the Valley Gate, Dragon's Well, Refuse Gate, King's Pool. He saw what others didn't. Robert Kennedy famously said, some men see things as they are and ask why. I dream of things as they've never been and ask why not. That was Nehemiah. It doesn't have to be this way. Note verse 17. Come, let us rebuild the walls of Jerusalem so we'll no longer be a reproach. It doesn't have to be this way. And Nehemiah goes to him. He says, sometimes we can get so desensitized to the world around us that we can walk by the Valley Gate and miss the fact that it's burned with fire. And God sends him an outsider, somebody from outside the community who's not used to the surroundings, and he brings a freshness to them. Can I step on your toes a little bit? This happens at church all the time. All the time this happens at church. New members come into the church, and they have a hard time breaking into the ranks because the old guard are afraid of the new ideas and the change that might come from them. That's what Nehemiah is saying. Hey, fresh eyes. You know, sometimes it's the new employee of the company that opens the window and lets the fresh air in. And that's what Nehemiah has to do. He's trying to get them to see what they hadn't seen. They'd been walking by the charred gates, the piles of brick and rubble. But notice, Nehemiah doesn't just see the physical. He sees through the physical and he sees the spiritual. This is the city of David. This is Jerusalem. We're supposed to shine the name of God to all the world. Remember that from a few weeks ago? He's concerned, that reproach. Remember we talked about that word reproach? He was concerned about the name. It was the name of God at stake. It was God's glory at stake. And Nehemiah is saying, hey, it's worse than some broken down walls. It's worse than some burned gates. It's God's name at stake. And I think the church needs to rediscover that doctrine. It's God's glory at stake. That we're to be zealous for his glory. We should care about it. And so look how Nehemiah appeals to them. Look, he appeals to their spiritual instinct. He appeals to their sense of what is right and what is moral. He doesn't call them to rebuild the walls because then it will be safe. He doesn't call them to rebuild the walls because then they'll have financial prosperity. He doesn't call them to rebuild the walls because then their kids will rest easy. No. What's he say? He says, then we'll no longer be of reproach. He motivates them. He motivates them with the spiritual idea that it's God's glory at stake. It's zeal for God. That this is about God's glory being manifest in God's people. No more reproach. He said, let's rebuild. Apply that to you. What motivates you, First of Ann? What motivates you best? Is it guilt? Don't I need to stand up here and beat you down and tell you how pathetic you are and say when you walk out those doors, you better watch out because God's going to zap you with lightning? Is it guilt? Is that what motivates you? That's not what motivates you. Is it good? Do I need to motivate you with good? Just volunteer because it'll come back around. It'll be good for you. Just give your tithe because it'll come back. It'll help. It'll be good for all of us. Is it good? Do I need to motivate you with good? No. It's not guilt. It's not good. It's glory. It's glory. That's what Nehemiah says. This is about zeal for God. I've been I guess, on a series of illustrations from Churchill, so why end it? Here's another Churchill illustration. You know, think about when Churchill had to recruit an army of Tommies to join the fight. What did he do? He appealed to the fact that Nazism was evil and that Germany needed to be faced down. He famously said, "I've got nothing to offer you but blood, toil, sweat, and tears." And yet he motivated them to sign up, grab a uniform, get a rifle, put on a helmet, and go out there into a cold, muddy, hungry trench. He had nothing to motivate them but a seemingly imminent death in an early grave. But he appealed to something deep in their hearts, to a value of what is right, that there was something that was right. That it was right to fight on the beaches, and it was right to fight in the seas, and it was right to fight in the air, and to never, never, never surrender. He gave them a cause. And that's what Nehemiah has here. He's got a cause. He doesn't need a stick. He doesn't need a carrot. He's got a cause. It's the glory of God. And notice a final observation here. It was personal to him. It was close. That's what good leaders do. They get involved. We can't inspire people at a distance. Note the personal pronouns here. Note the personal pronouns. First person, personal pronouns. Come, let us rebuild the wall so that we will no longer be approached. Verse 17. They mocked us. They despised us. Verse 19. The God of heaven will give us success. Therefore, we, his servants, will arise and build. Verse 20. Nehemiah narrows the distance between himself and the people, not merely by walking, not merely by traveling to the city, but by his very language. He says, "I'm a part of the cause, that I'm gonna join you. I'm gonna participate with you. I'm not gonna conduct all this from Susa, the capital. I've come here to be a part." That's what leaders do. They don't push from behind. They lead from the front. They don't ask people to do something that they're unwilling to do themselves. And Nehemiah is not passive. He's not in some office somewhere pushing paper. He leads by example. He says, "Let's arise and build." He includes himself in the work. I can't lead this church behind a closed door and a couple of admins. I lead from the front. Can't lead this church. Can't drive this church from the back seat. Okay, you lead from the front. Nehemiah is on the wall. That's what leaders do. Leaders get on the wall. Hey, when you mother like that, when you're a mother like that, watch how your kids cooperatively follow. When you're a husband like that, watch how your wife swoons to follow that. When you're an elder like that, watch how the congregation willingly submits to that. When you're an employer like that, watch how your employees rush to follow you in that. You do these things, and people will follow gladly and get involved. Why? Because they see the cause in you. They see you doing something about the cause. And watch this, final point. They see how you give the cause and the credit away. Look at verse 18. "I told them how the hand of my God has been favorable to me." Look what Nehemiah is doing. He wants his followers to know that it's God at work. It's the good hand of God, that he didn't go to King Artaxerxes and somehow manipulate him to giving him a passport to pass through all those provinces. That he didn't appeal to the queen who was sitting beside Artaxerxes so he could get some lumber from the king's forest. No, it wasn't about that. Friends, in 2:18, Nehemiah is getting the Jews to understand what he already discovered in 2:8. In 2:18, he's getting them to see what he has already found in 2:8. You see how they run parallel? This is God's glory. All the honor, all the praise, all the glory to him. You remember that scene in 1 Samuel 17? David's going out. He thinks his brothers have been in the front lines fighting. He's got a sack full of cheese, some loaves of bread. And he gets up to the front lines. And what's he find? Well, King Saul is hiding in his tent. And the armies of God are shaking in their boots or sandals or whatever they're wearing. And he looks down in the valley and he sees that warrior Goliath. And he's been taunting the armies of the living God for 40 days, morning and night. And there's something interesting that happens in that text. You know, David didn't know, but in verse 25, that the man who would go out to fight Goliath, Saul had promised to give him his own daughter, the princess, great riches, a portion of his kingdom. Is that why David fought Goliath? Is that what he was interested in? Did he just go in verse 25? Did he hear verse 25? Oh, princess, I'll do it now. Is that what he did? No, no, no. Look at verse 26 when you get home. Now, David said, how dare this man insult the armies of the living God? How dare he take the name of God in vain? How dare he defame God and blaspheme his name? That was motivation enough for David. He didn't need a wife. He didn't need great riches. He didn't need a kingdom. No, it was enough for him. God's cause was enough. God's fame was enough. Biblical leadership has a biblical cause, and God is worthy, friends, of our service. His motivation is enough. Zeal for his glory is enough. I don't come to you with a carrot or a stick. I come to you with visions of God's glory at stake. Does that motivate you? Is the glory of God enough for you? It was enough for David. It was enough for Nehemiah. It's enough for me. What say you, First of Anne? What say you? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we want your glory. We want your glory to be made manifest. We give you all the honor and all the glory and all the praise. Father, make us leaders like Nehemiah. We look in our city. We look in our country. We see weakness. No courage. No bold leadership, no backbone from Main Street to Wall Street, from Pennsylvania Avenue to First Street, no leadership. God, make us biblical leaders like me and Nehemiah who care about your glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
Our Savior Jesus is the one who is the ultimate example of doing what he asks his followers to do. He asks us to die to ourselves. And he himself went to the cross. Let's stand and ask him to help us abide in him.
I depend.
Receive this as your benediction. Psalm 121. The Lord protect you from all evil. May he keep your soul. May he guard your going out and your coming in from this time forth and forever. We'll see you next week.